Mosaic layouts have become a popular design trend on websites, offering a visually engaging and dynamic way to present content. In this video, we will start with a single block and then progressively create a 5-block mosaic layout using the CSS grid. But before we dive in, don't forget to subscribe to our channel and hit the notification bell to stay updated on our web development tutorials. Let's begin. We've established a simple HTML structure with a page container classed as PageWidth. Inside, there's a section element serving as the wrapper for the grid. Next up, we have a child container labeled with the CSS class MosaicBlock to hold both the image and title. If you have any preferred CSS naming convention, feel free to use it. Just remember to adjust the CSS accordingly. Now, with the HTML set, we have some foundational styles already waiting for us in the CSS. It's time to dive into the mosaic layout. Firstly, we transform our layout into a CSS grid using the display grid property. Introducing a gap of 1 rem, which is equivalent to 16 pixels in this case, will create breathing space between images. The image inside of the mosaic block is positioned absolutely. Having a width and height of 100%, along with the object fit set as cover, will make sure the image covers the entire block while still maintaining its aspect ratio. Since we're using absolute positioning with the image, its parent container should be set as position relative. Next, let's apply some basic presentational styles to the heading, including font size, weight, color, and padding. If you notice, the heading seems to be hidden behind the image. To fix this, we can set it as position relative. The user select none will prevent any unintended user selection. Now, let's give the heading a subtle background to create depth between the image and the text. It will also enhance the readability. We can achieve this by applying a black gradient, which runs from top to bottom. Its intensity can be adjusted by tweaking the alpha channel of the solid color. To further enhance its appearance, we can add the border radius and overflow hidden to the parent div. Utilizing the hover pseudo class along with the transition property will provide a smooth zoom-in effect when hovering over the image. Lastly, setting a desired minimum height for the parent div will finalize the first layout of this series. Now let's introduce the second block of the grid and update the CSS class to Mosaic Layout 2. You might be wondering why we haven't used the Mosaic Layout 1 class anywhere in our CSS. This is because we didn't need any specific styles for the first layout, but I've kept it in the HTML for consistency and clarity. Moving forward, let's configure the Grid Template Columns property to divide the second layout into two separate columns. Using the FR unit, which represents a fraction of the available space in the grid container, we can ensure that the first column consumes twice the space of the second one. For example, if we have a total width of 100 pixels, subtracting 16 pixels for the gap leaves us with 84 pixels of remaining space. The first column will utilize 2/3 of this space, leaving 1/3 for the second column. Moving on to the third layout, we need to add one more image block to the HTML, and as you guessed, the CSS class will be updated to the Mosaic Layout 3. Returning to the CSS, the grid configuration for the third layout mirrors the second layout we just finished. Hence, we can group our CSS classes and reuse the same CSS rules wherever possible. Let's slightly reduce the minimum height for the third layout. Now we want to expand the height of the first column so that it covers 2 rows of the grid. To make things easier, let's utilize the dev tools to inspect the grid layout. We can easily toggle the display of the layout directly on the page by clicking the badge next to the grid container. If we give it a closer look, the grid is divided into 4 grid areas arranged in a 2x2 configuration. Here, we are using nthchild pseudo class to target the first image block. The grid area property with the value of 1, 1, 3, and 2 assigns 2 consecutive grid areas along the block axis to the first image. These numbers correspond to the grid lines that make up the structure of the grid. The grid lines can either be horizontal, known as the row grid lines, or vertical, known as the column grid lines. The grid area is a shorthand property. When 4 values are specified, grid row starts takes the first value, grid column start takes the second, the grid row end, and the grid column end take the 3rd and 4th. In this instance, the first image starts at the intersection of the first row grid line and the first column grid line, and ends at the intersection of the 3rd row grid line and the 2nd column grid line. We could also use the grid row start and grid row end properties separately. Here, we're specifying to start at the 1st row grid line and end at the 3rd row grid line. This can be further simplified by utilizing the grid row shorthand property. The span keyword indicates that the image should span across two rows. And that was all for the third layout. Now let's proceed to work on the fourth design. Once again, we require a new image block and need to update the class name accordingly. In the CSS, the grid configuration for the fourth design will be slightly different. This time, the grid will be divided into three columns. Since all columns are equally divided, we can utilize the repeat function. The first value of the repeat function sets the number of columns, and the second value defines the size of each column. Now comes the alignment. Once again, we can utilize the nth child pseudoclass to target the first image. Here, the first image starts from the first line of the block axis and ends at the third line of the block axis. Similarly, the fourth image starts from the second line of the block axis and ends at the fourth line of the block axis. As before, we can simplify this using the span keyword. In this case, both the first and fourth images will span across two columns. Let's take another step forward and add the fifth image to our HTML. Additionally, attach the class name for the fifth layout. Since the grid configuration for the fifth layout resembles that of the second and third layouts, we can reuse the same CSS rules. This time, both the first and fourth images will span across three rows, while the second, third, and fifth images will occupy two rows each. Finally, depending on the requirement, we can implement a media query to reconfigure the layout for small screen devices. Here, we're resetting the grid to maintain a single column layout for screens below 575 pixels. And that's how we can utilize CSS grids for creating eye-catching web layouts, ideal for showcasing image galleries and promotional content. By organizing images, text, and other media elements within a grid-like structure, mosaic layouts effectively capture attention and encourage exploration. Feel free to experiment with the code by following the link provided in the description. Share your suggestions or feedback in the comments below, and don't forget to like, share, and subscribe to stay tuned for upcoming web development tutorials. Thanks for watching.